Can you hear me at the back over there? Oh, that sounds good. There's something really delicious about coming to a city which is essentially timeless. Well, there goes the... Let me just go. Coming to a city which is essentially timeless to talk about the only thing which is constant in our industry, which is change. And my mandate this morning was to talk about the next 5 years on the client and in the cloud or in the data center. Now, 5 years is an extraordinary time. If we look back 5 years, we were in a very, very different world where very few of the topics which currently define the headlines in technology were even speculated about. So 5 years is a great distance to speculate about. Fortunately, that means we can keep it tight, we can keep it inspirational. And so really what I want to do is use the next 20 minutes to seed some ideas about fundamental changes that I think are likely to take place in the field of personal and enterprise computing. So Microsoft came out recently and presented Windows 8 very, very clearly as a platform for both tablet and desktop computing. And so they've essentially said that in their view, those two form factors converge into one device. My own perspective is that the level of convergence will go substantially further, that within 5 years, the average person will carry only one device. And that device will look just like a phone because it will be a phone, and it will run one platform, but have many, many faces. So fundamentally, on the client side, what we're looking at is a condensation, distillation of all of the functionality that the average person uses today into a single device. And the use of alternative docking form factors, essentially, to give you the experience of either a tablet or a desktop or a phone, depending on what you need to get done. How many of you have seen the Motorola Atrix, which was the first device, essentially, to be both a desktop and a telephone? Anybody here actually used one? So this is a device produced by Motorola, which they've struggled to describe. It's they call it a sort of a web book and telephone. But essentially, it gives you all of the benefits, the productivity benefits, of a laptop. You dock it to a clamshell form factor that has an extra battery and an extra screen. And then you have the phone and the desktop, so you can work productively. It's built on Ubuntu. And other manufacturers are working on similar products, so we know that this is a form factor that's going to be more widely available. For phone manufacturers, this is very attractive because for the first time, they have a real reason to put meaty horsepower into high-end smartphones. The CPUs of high-end smartphones today are perfectly capable of driving low-end desktop workloads. And more than capable for all of the things that we want to put on a phone. So the challenge for smartphone makers is how to create a demand for higher-end products in the smartphone audience. People can't tell the difference if you're just running it as a phone between a high-end processor and a mid-range processor anymore. So there's a real opportunity here for phone manufacturers. And there's a real opportunity for end users, too, because the difference between having to carry multiple devices and carry a single device is phenomenal in terms of your lifestyle. Now, these things always take longer to happen than you think they will, and then when they happen much faster. The key things that have to fall into place for this to become true, essentially, is that we need some sort of pervasive standard for the docking experience of this single form factor device. And I think that's going to shake out. Apple will have, obviously, their standard dock, but a standard will emerge for the rest of the industry as well. So this shift will have fundamental implications for us in the consumer Linux game, essentially. We're going to have to figure out how to make GNU Linux, standard GNU Linux, work really efficiently in mobile form factors. And that's going to be a substantial amount of work over the next year or two, but you'll see that as a real focus. In Ubuntu, we've been working very closely with ARM through a vehicle called Linaro, and the focus of that has essentially been to make it possible for people to bring up on a mobile form factor, either Ubuntu or Android, very efficiently, very easily, to treat ARM much more like a standard PC environment, essentially. And to do that both from the perspective of mobile computing environments and also from the perspective of the server. We talk a lot these days about something called Ubuntu Core, which is essentially all the heart of Ubuntu, the engine room of Ubuntu. Essentially Debian, but on the Ubuntu time scale with the Ubuntu release cadence and support commitments as an underlying basis for all sorts of different products that people are building. I think there's a real need for an industry standard core. I don't believe that will come from a consortium, but I do think it could come from something like Ubuntu Core, which is royalty-free, which is already enabled and tested and certified on many of these platforms, and which has all of the sort of generic components and pieces that people need to build their own custom user experiences on. So that's going to be an important challenge for us. In terms of the actual consumer experience, I think the fundamental shift that we'll see over the next 5 years is related to connectivity and the personal cloud. The idea that that your device will be perfectly backed up all the time, that you will essentially have all of your data simultaneously accessible from your one personal device, but then from any other device via the cloud as well, using a combination of streaming and caching and replication. Now, there are some fundamental questions there, for example. Will all of that data live at Google and all of the privacy and jurisdictional questions that raises? Or will it essentially be a distributed data infrastructure with the end user having more control over that? There's some fundamental challenges and questions there. In Ubuntu, a key focus for us has been Ubuntu One, which is a framework for online services delivered straight to the desktop. There are services now which cover music, the ability to sort of buy and store and share music, music streaming, general file replication, syncing and storage. What's really important for us there is cross-platform capabilities, so the ability to deliver your files to Windows, your files to Android or iOS, your files to the web, so that you genuinely have the ability to have a common content pool across all platforms and across all devices. And on the corporate front, I think we really are seeing Windows getting squeezed into a very uncomfortable position. Today, most corporate IT managers are thinking about Windows as a service, Windows as a capability that they can deliver to any screen, regardless of the underlying platform of that screen. And I think that's a very healthy situation. The reality is there is a great deal of value to enterprises in their historical Windows deployments and in the practices and application richness that they have from that environment. But there are also real challenges for them in the management of that environment and in its susceptibility to malware. So thinking of Windows applications as a service that you can deliver allows you to take the right platform choice for a particular profile of user and still have the flexibility to deliver applications to them from any underlying platform. So we see a great deal of innovation in this space today, a really marked increase in the willingness of enterprises to explore alternative platforms on the desktop. Some of those are straightforward migrations. There are some very large businesses now that have found that it was fairly easy to move 10% of their workforce. So if you have 50,000 desktops, moving 5,000 desktops is a savings that essentially mitigates the increased cost of some of the new Windows licensing schemes. So large organizations typically easily move 10% of their desktops. We see some organizations moving 80 or 90, but mostly it's organizations taking a sort of an easy bite of about 10% of their desktops to an open platform like Ubuntu, and then finding opportunities to grow based on that. So on the server front, I think what we're in right now is very much like the early days of the web. So the web around about 1995. There were network services that were fairly well established, and then the web came along, and slowly the web consumed all the other services. Today, you know, if you're thinking of creating a new service, you will typically build it on top of HTTP as a standard protocol, even though HTTP has all sorts of sort of fairly hard design constraints that don't necessarily make it the easiest protocol to support for a particular kind of service. It's so widely deployed, so well understood, so rounded now, that you can essentially model any other protocol on top of HTTP. So we see, you know, old protocols like SMTP getting eliminated in favor fundamentally of HTTP. And that was a transition that's taken 15 years.